welcome to you all. Good morning to you. After the strenuous and bibulous exercises of last night, I guess I'm not too surprised that we don't have more Quincy House students awake than in the audience, but we'll hope that they'll straggle in as the morning goes along. We have a very fine program planned for you, as you can see. I'd like to get into it fairly quickly. Immediately after the program, we'll have a picnic in the courtyard, and then after that, I know a great number of you are going to the football game. The Harvard Band, I'm told, is going to salute us with a song and with a formation in their pre-game ceremonies, so if you want to get there a little early, you may see that. Before going on, let me just say a word or two about Harvard and the House system. It's something that I care deeply about and I'm very pleased to be involved with. When the Puritan fathers first established Harvard College in the 1630s, they really had two choices as to how the institution would be organized. They could choose the Dutch model, which would be to have students live wherever they chose in the community of the building where the instruction was taken. Or they could choose the English model, which was to have the students and the tutors living together, enjoying a common life under the same roof, dining together, and learning together. Most of them, the leaders of that first Massachusetts Bay colony, had spent time in Holland, and they knew the Dutch model very, very well indeed. But they chose the English model, which was to unite living and learning, to combine the particularities of daily life with the pursuit of learning in libraries and with instructors. And that combination of living and learning has been a hallmark here at Harvard for 3.5 centuries now. In the early part of the 18th century, it was a Harvard man who traveled to New Haven to found Yale. People don't realize that Yale was a Harvard graduate. In the early 20th century, it was a Yale man who came to Harvard and gave us $13 million to establish the House system as we know it now. So that in 1929 and 1930, these magnificent houses along the Charles River were being constructed thanks to his benefaction. And they have become one of the finest resources and features, I think, of collegiate life here or anywhere else. The first seven were constructed here to the west of us. Quincy House was the eighth of the houses to be established in 1959. 25 years ago, so it is appropriate that we have a program of this sort, and the celebrations of last night and today to mark this occasion. Let me urge your attention, and let me wish you a very good day. I hope you enjoy the program, and let me call on Mary Jo, our music tutor, to bring up her group and start off our festivities.
Music this morning has been chosen to honor Elliot Forbes and to reflect the diversity of his musical tastes. The piece we're going to perform for you now is one of his favorites. It was recorded in Athens on the 1961 Asian tour while he was conductor of the Glee Club. The Glee Club has generously donated to the Quincy House Library a complete set of all the recordings made with El as conductor while he was conductor of the Glee Club, and we are going to use this as a cornerstone of the Elliot Forbes collection in the library, where we hope to gather all the pieces which El has arranged and composed, one of which we would have sung to you this morning, but El is so difficult. We needed more time. So here you go.
Oh.
great pleasure to have the president of the university with us here this morning to help us celebrate. President Bach is a great supporter of the House system. He has given it great resources and much time under his administration in the last dozen years. The House system has been strengthened in numerous ways, so it's a happy occasion to have him here, Harvard's 25th president, to help us celebrate our 25th birthday.
Thank you very much, David. It's always a particular pleasure to come to Quincy House and be reminded of that inspiring predecessor to all of us who have served in the intervening years, Josiah Quincy, the only Harvard president in our 348-year history who ever expelled an entire class for which he was hung in effigy from the Liberty, no, not the Liberty tree, he was hung in effigy from the Rebellion tree, which has been mercifully cut down since. One of the nice things about an occasion like this is it gives a chance to remember and remind ourselves of a little longer perspective on Harvard's history. Because if you're a student and you're passing through here in only 4 years, I know that the pace of change must often seem excruciatingly slow. But when we celebrate the 25th year anniversaries, or we look back on the House system, which extends over 50 years, it does give us a chance to see how much actually does change at some constant glacial pace. I think it's worth reminding ourselves of an occasion like this as we enjoy the hospitality of last night and to think about what Quincy House in its newly remodeled state has come to be. To remind ourselves just for a moment of what life was like before the House system came into being. Because even though the Puritan founders of Harvard may have accepted the English rather than the Dutch model, it was not a model that was perfectly realized for a great many years. Up to the advent of the House system, you had only, as I understand it, freshmen and seniors who were assured of university accommodations. The rest of the students lived wherever they could find accommodations. What that meant, of course, was that these wealthy students from the prep schools, which was a much larger fraction of the class, lived in luxury apartments called the Gold Coast, with swimming pools and all sorts of elegances and extravagances, while the poorer students, most of them from public schools, had to find accommodations where they could, usually in tenements and run-down boarding houses of various kinds. Those arrangements, of course, accentuated the class system within the college, so that there was one group of students with their clubs, with their Boston parties, their debutante balls, and there was another group of students who lacked those privileges, who lived a different kind of life, usually working their way through. And scrounging up living accommodations as best they could. That, of course, was not a very healthy environment and took away what many of us feel to be the most priceless opportunity of a Harvard undergraduate education, the chance to really enjoy the diversity of an extraordinarily varied, wonderful group of students. It was, as David said, the accident of Mr. Harkness coming into President Lowell's office after he had been turned down or subjected to unconscionable delays by his alma mater, agreeing to pay millions of dollars to try to emulate something of the British system and establish a House system here at Harvard that made it all possible. Everyone since Lowell, every president that I know of, has been sitting around listening for the bell to ring in Massachusetts Hall, hoping that some donor will come in with some other magnificent scheme with millions of dollars in his pocket. I've only been in office 13 years, but I'm still waiting. Yale will once again make a mistake and then send an enormously wealthy donor here to do some glorious thing for us all. But strangely enough, the reaction to these millions of dollars and the proposal for a House plan was, as you would think, in Harvard's contentious, critical, and skeptical tradition, very mixed. The faculty was not keen on the idea. They felt something was being railroaded through. After all, they hadn't been consulted. It wasn't their idea. Therefore, there was something obviously wrong with it. The Crimson, of course, was opposed. Unnecessary, unwarranted, premature. They hadn't thought of it either. The club saw it as a threat to their privileged existence, so they protested, and they were much more powerful in those days. Only the student council and President Lowell were resolutely in favor, and it is to them, I think, that we owe a debt of gratitude that we have a Quincy House or any other house here at Harvard. I think all of you would agree that their determination has paid off handsomely, despite the opposition that they encountered. It's always tempting to look back upon some golden age. I often hear people talk with misty eyes about the time when there were silver candelabra, when there were linen tablecloths, or when there were people who ran around and made your beds, when everything was clean and spotless, and students were pampered all day long. But strangely enough, and I think this is a tribute to people throughout the 50-year history of the houses and the 25-year history of this house, we do happen to have surveys, indications, pretty good indications of student opinion at roughly 10-year intervals since the houses were first opened 50 years ago. And interestingly enough, from all of that evidence, it appears that the appreciation that students have for the houses has steadily grown from the opening decade until the present. Until now, it seems to me, it is one of the most popular and appreciated features of Harvard life, not simply as a matter of living arrangements, but as something that contributes to the total value of a Harvard undergraduate educational experience. For that, we owe a great deal to a lot of people, certainly to masters like the Aloyans, his distinguished exorcist predecessor, and the senior tutors like Elliot Cohen, and all the other tutors who worked so hard to, I think, get so much out of having the house experience with all of you. But certainly these houses can't ever hope to be very much better than the students who live in them. This is your community. Whatever success it achieves has to be in large part due what you put into it. So if the houses have steadily gotten better through 50 years, if the appreciation students have has steadily grown, that must be due to not only to the students that are here, but to the alumni in the audience and their classmates who work now over half a century, and in this house's case, a quarter of a century, to find new ways of making this community function better for those who live within it. I think we still have frontiers to conquer. We have never managed to accomplish all that President Lowell hoped we would accomplish to integrate the houses into the educational process of the college. But now that we've met a number of other challenges, now that the houses are on a pretty good financial footing, now that we have finally moved into the 20th century, thoroughly integrated co-educational living into the house system with all the improvements that makes possible, I think perhaps we can, we have cleared the decks and we can begin to take a serious look at whether there are additional educational opportunities that we can build into the house system to make it an even richer experience than it is already. And so we have a lot to be thankful for and to celebrate, and that is what we should be doing, not listening to superannuated presidents. So let me simply tell you what pleasure it is to be here and how much of a debt we owe to those who do so much to make the house as good as it is, and I wish you another 25 years, even better if possible, than the quarter century you've just spent. Thank you very much.
Thank you. much to it all. That is until my senior year when I had to go home for Christmas vacation and decide what colleges to apply to. I can recall those lucky few that knew what they wanted to be when they grew up. And for them, the choice was easy. They selected the university that had the best departments in their field. They applied, got in, and lived happily ever after. And then there's the rest of us. We didn't know what we wanted to be or what kind of job we wanted to have. I still don't know. And after listening to my older brothers and sisters' horror stories about getting out into the real world, grad school was looking real good. So anyway, there were lots of variables to consider when applying to college. For instance, the location of the college, where my friends were applying, where my mom and dad went, and where my mom and dad wanted me to go. I may have even let the prospective university's reputations influence my decision. I know I can speak for every alumni and student in this room when I say that our school's rep is in a class by itself, which does, on occasion, have its disadvantages. Has this ever happened to you? My father didn't believe it could until he was there. You walk into a party and or a group of people, and someone comes up and asks everyone what school they go to. When it goes down the line, UCLA, University of Colorado, Oregon State, Harvard, they go, "Oh, you do not." Seriously. And of course, at that point, my friends have to go, "Oh, did he tell you he goes to Harvard?" "Hey, cut it out. That'll never get you the chance, you know?" So at that point, I mean, you don't know, but I've been told that it's all worth enduring. So we made the choice to come here, one of the most diverse places, let alone universities in the world. And all of a sudden, freshman year, just when you think you've made it, you're hit with a whole other battery of decisions, like what newspaper to comp for, what sport to play, and it goes down the line when you even have to decide what major you want to be in. Having completed more than three quarters of the collegiate process, I can look back and say that no decision was more important, nor to affect my years at Harvard more than which house I put down as my number one choice on the lottery application. Like universities, each house has different facilities, reputations, student bodies, and locations. But seriously, did you ever see one of your freshman buddies that was quadded ever again? All of these factors play a role in the decision-making process, along with roommates' preferences. And I do get the impression that house reputation may be one of the most significant ones of all. Considering the fact that one of the upper class houses is probably going to be one's home, and I stress the word home, for the next three academic years, one doesn't want to live where he or she is not going to fit in and have fun. And I don't want to get too specific because stereotypes tend to shift around to different houses over 25 years, and I don't want to exclude any of you listeners. But where I will get specific and where I will try to describe the reputation in detail is about the one house I know best, the Quincy House of today. My knowledge of the place preceded that of any other, because my dad happens to be a classmate of Master Loyan's. And thus, Quincy House came highly recommended. In the beginning, that was good enough for me. It wasn't until last spring, though, that I became acutely interested in discovering the general reputation of my home. I was giving freshmen tours of their prospective dwelling, and I asked them what they thought. Everyone seemed to know the past reputation of Quincy House, and they all knew it had passed. But no one was really quite sure if this Quincy House had any stereotype, other than that it had been the most popular house in the lottery in recent years. Everyone was quite willing to try and explain the reputation, but no one could really pin it down. That is, all the answers were quite vague. And talking with the master about this a few days ago in the courtyard, we did come up with a reputation that seems to fit all the data. Quincy House is a friendly house. And on the East Coast that's characterized by cold weather and even colder glances from passersby, I find Quincy House's courtyard and hallways are an oasis from the elements. When I stop to think of how many people say hello to me as I walk by and ask how I am, and then actually stop and listen to the response, I can really be pleased with my decision to live here in an environment that is so conducive to good times and good people. And the people that make up the house are very, very important. Also, Quincy is a very diverse house, which can explain why no one could come up with an overall stereotype. Quincy has its share of everything from jocks to musicians, pre-meds to Midwesterners. In fact, out of all the houses, I would dare to say that Quincy best represents the diversity of the university's population as a whole. Which, in one sense, is great, because we, as Quincy residents, are exposed to the total Harvard experience more than any other group. But it also makes the jobs for me and the other House Committee officers that much tougher. Because we are not working with a cohesive student body, it is often difficult to plan any activities that just a majority of the House will think is worthwhile, let alone attend, which can be seen if any of you know our Strauss Cup standings for the past few years. We barely beat out Dudley House. But this attitude in the house is changing. I've noticed it differ around here in just the past 2 weeks. People are psyched to be members of Quincy House, and one could say that we all have a certain pride about living here in the most popular house. And a lot of that, I find, is due to the reason we're all here this morning. The celebration of Quincy House's 25th anniversary has given the entire population of this place something in common, something to work for, something to play with, all in order to pay tribute to our home, Quincy House, Harvard's house. And I would just like to thank you all for making this event a success and giving this place the honor it deserves. And I'd like to say that I'm very proud to have played a small part in it.
Thank you. section of my memory blocks, but there are other things I can turn to. Sometimes, for instance, Quincy House was not entirely melodious. In order to prevent the possibility of disharmony, I was urged by some tutors in Lowell House who were experts in government that when I came to Quincy House, I should proclaim my powers as a master by making some overt public exhibition of myself. Being a modest person and trying to hide, I instead persuaded the senior common room of Quincy House and the senior common room of Lowell House to make exhibitions of themselves, and I quietly marched in their midst along with Seth Stewart to the sound of the bagpipes, making as little stir in Cambridge as possible. So we marched out of the courtyard and started going around, and by the time we got to the street behind, I noticed that there was a very anxious looking set of policemen driving slowly along beside Seth Stewart and myself and looking anxiously at our piper. I remember that the pipes have been declared an instrument of war in courts such as the United Nations, and so I did become a little anxious myself and said to Zeph, they wouldn't arrest two masters. And Zeph said, what makes you think that? They're Cambridge police, not so anyway, we got back alive, unarrested, to the courtyard, and then I played one short blast on pipes myself, and thereby discovered the law of life, and that is, the less you play the pipes, the greater your fame as a piper. I also gave a very brief exorcism, being a member of the Department of Folklore and Mythology. It's very easy for any member of that department to conjure up something appropriate. In this case, it included a kind of umbrella insurance to protect all of Quincy House, plus Cahaley's, which used to be a very important part of social life in Quincy House, from any mishap and from the attacks of any malign spirits. And I'm most delighted to notice that Master Loyne has still been continuing that. It only was intended as a one-shot deal, but it became more and more elaborate year after year. So that inevitably is one of my reminiscences. Another reminiscence, of course, inevitably deals with the disharmony of the student revolutionary years. I have never considered myself a political expert. I'm quite good at medieval history, but 20th century history, somehow the key to it eludes me. I went down to Women's City Club to speak to the Radcliffe women's group during the revolutions that were raging all over universities in this continent. And I was asked whether there was any chance of revolution at Harvard. And I said, good gracious, no. I know all the students so well in Quincy House, I can't imagine. I know their sentiments, their feelings, and so on. But apparently there must have been students in some other houses that I didn't know. Because by a most unfortunate coincidence, such as exorcisms are designed to prevent, we had planned, the senior common room and the house committee had planned together to initiate when members of the undergraduate body of Quincy House got together and offered to the university, offered Quincy House as the first place to experiment in co-residential living. And it all came to pass, and when the count was made, it was found that it would be necessary that one male should have to leave the building the following year when the women arrived, and guess who offered to do it, since no one else volunteered? Goldfinger himself. He went up to live at what was then still called Redcliffe. I always think of him as a Quincy House hero. Life improved so enormously in Quincy House after that that one would never wish to go back. Another footnote, by the way, I seem to be overlooking the part played by the faculty in all these matters. They do play a very large part. The faculty immediately formed a committee to study the matters relating to co-residents. They got Professor Kagan, Jerome Kagan, distinguished psychologist, to gather together a committee who could define the appropriate ratio of men to women in a residence. It had seemed to me, secretly, that 50-50 was kind of fun, but no, that wasn't actually possible. And so by some extraordinary coincidence, possibly there was a mathematician on the committee, the ideal ratio happened to be precisely the ratio of men in Harvard to women in Radcliffe. So, be that as it may, we proceeded with an ever-increasing part of that ratio made up of women, and they certainly were a most welcome addition to what otherwise was a rather jockish, noisy, uncivilized atmosphere. No offense to any of you, many of whom I recognize here, who lived here in those early days before co-residence, but I think if you tried it now, you'd notice the difference immediately. Finally, I promised to speak not more than 5 minutes, and I know it's over 5 minutes now. I would say that my chief memory is, in fact, because of the house system, the memory of the students that I came to know. I can't say that I know all 2,000, let us say, to whom I have given out diplomas, by name and so on, but if any of you want to try me out, you may be quite startled to know how much I do remember about you. In the old days, the file folders would really make lurid reading. Now, I can't help but remember some of the things in them. Nowadays, the files are pretty dull stuff indeed. But the students were what made life absolutely delightful for myself, my first wife, later for my second wife, and for Alexander, now 8 years old. For all of us, the association with students has been a most precious one. I used to wonder how students all turned out to be such attractive people. I decided it must be the admissions committee. Surely the admissions committee is infallible. But finally, I came to realize a greater truth, and that is, it's the students who came here who were infallible, not just the admissions committee. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
take a few moments to express my gratitude to the dozens of people who have worked together in the last 10 days or so to organize this event, last night's and today's. Obviously, a great deal of effort must go into such a celebration, and I can't let this opportunity pass without thanking Peter Miller and the officers of the House Committee for all of the work they did in receptions and hosting alumni and helping arrangements and getting the particulars of rooms established and so on. I can't thank enough the assistant to the masters, Paula Jones. Paula's been here early every morning for the last 2 weeks and has been here late many hours after 5 o'clock, seeing to the numerous details. Mary Jo Santa Baron has been marvelous in organizing this magnificent musical program that you've heard. She's been able to enlist the enthusiasm and cooperation of lots of people and work with them. We're indebted to you, Mary Jo, for all of that. Herb Littlejohn and his crew in the dining room, I hope you'll have a chance to acknowledge the appreciation I'm sure you all feel for their efforts. I can go on and on, and those who decorated the hall and so forth. I hope you'll join me in a round of applause for our appreciation for all the efforts of these wonderful people. Elliot Forbes has been a member of the senior common room since Quincy House opened its doors in September of 1959. And even though he has now retired from the faculty as of last June, I'm very, very happy to say that he's going to continue his membership in the senior common room and continue to come and visit us and be with us on many, many occasions in the years ahead. He is a great teacher. He was a conductor of the Glee Club that a number of you have performed with. He has been instrumental in encouraging and developing musical programs here in Quincy House for a quarter of a century, and we all owe him so very much. I must say that the alumni have responded warmly and generously to our effort to raise some money to establish an endowment fund for the arts in his name. I'm pleased to report that with the checks still coming in at a very high rate, we've reached the $10,000 level, and I suspect that by the end of the year we'll be able to double that amount. This means that in the years ahead, we will have a solid financial basis to fund the various programs in the arts that we will have in the fall, winter, and spring of each academic year. So that's a wonderful response thus far, and I'm grateful to all of you who've helped make it so good. Now, I'll let Elliot speak for himself and then perform for himself. Professor Elliot Forbes.
People to that wonderful row of individuals who made all of this possible, namely David and Mimi Aloyan themselves, who didn't go first of all. Welcome to returning House members. My return here was from Princeton in the spring of 1958. I got a call from the then dean of the faculty, Mac Bundy, telling me that he was forming a senior common room for a new Harvard house and asking would I consider being a candidate to be a part of this. It sounded adventuresome and I said yes. The next step was to be interviewed by master-to-be John Bullock, who I wish was here today. And this proved to be a rewarding occasion where, having sniffed pleasantly at each other, so to speak, it appeared to be a go. My next memory was over a year later, as the house opened in 1959, to discover the buildings, the space, and above all, the breathtaking view from the penthouse of Cambridge, Boston, and beyond, and to realize its claim to being by far the most glamorous and spectacular master's residence. My recollections of the senior common room center around two things. How congenial was the group gathered from the start? And secondly, what a different world we lived in. Consider, not only were there no women undergraduates in the house, but copying Lowell House, we had high table right here, all by our smug selves. This accounts for roughly 10 years of the life of the house, during which time we had the lively year 1961-62 of acting master Larry Wiley. Then came the great era of Charles Dunn, 1966-81. Charles the Unflappable, as I labeled him at a recent SCR dinner in town. All during the rest of this late 60s, his early years, Charles remained calm, astutely analyzing the changing times and worries. The dean of the college ordered all the masters at one point to appear at University Hall, one of the many crisis occasions. There they were, sitting dutifully in a row. While the other masters fretted, Charles, I am told, was seen quietly reading Crimson, Independent, and no doubt other intriguing matter. His approach was reflected in the house and in its activities. Women were absorbed easily and constructively. High table was abandoned as an antiquated concept, and members of the SCR were urged, as they continue to be today, to mingle vigorously with the undergraduates. It was fun to be a part of the ritual of Charles' latter years. First, the appointment of our first co-master, Elaine Dunn, in 1974, then the commissioning of Bob Amory to create the Quincy coat of arms, and again the plan to commission Marie Cassindus to create the fine photographic portrait of Charles in full regalia, which hangs in the senior common room. I wish that you all had had the treat that some of us have had of hearing Charles play the bagpipes and read A Christmas Carol at the holiday parties. I have to say that some of the dubious SCR dramatic offerings which followed, however, I'm just as glad to forget. It was my great privilege to be on the joint JCR-SCR committee that met with the powers that be in Massachusetts and University Halls to find Charles Dunn's successor. And I had the special pleasure, after it was a fait accompli, of crossing the yard to Wadsworth House to tell David Loyan that his appointment was definite. Following that are two warm memories over drinks in the house library. One, of meeting Charles, telling him the good news, and hearing him explode, "What a splendid choice." And second, of experiencing the first meeting with our new co-master, Mimi Aloyan. And now, the fourth year of the Aloyans ushers in the house's silver anniversary. A word about the arts at Quincy House. Right away, John Bullitt established the tradition of carols at the Christmas holiday party, and we used to have a house glee club to serve up a few of these already rehearsed before starting a general sing. I remember various instrumental accompanists for these sings, like the Joel Cortes on recorders. Through a series of dedicated music tutors, two kinds of musical gatherings were established and maintained. The intimate concerts, those wonderful concerts, in the master's residence on the one end, and the larger, more formal concerts in the dining room on the other. We have been fortunate in the ideal acoustics of this room. Music and drama developed. Again, productions could be of two kinds, both equally effective. Intimate plays in the junior common room with a minimum of props, or fully staged drama in the dining room. Then dance was added. One high point was a production of one of Bernstein's musical ballets, and Lenny was able to get to one of the performances and meet with the troupe afterwards. What has been heartening is the recent development of the other arts: painting, sculpture, photography, film, and ceramics, much of it under the guidance and stimulation of Mimi Aloyan. For the last 2 years, we have had an arts festival in the spring, which combines two desirable characteristics. One, representation of all the arts, shows, exhibits, concerts. And second, emphasis on house talent, as you've just heard this morning. Thanks to Mary Jo. Most of the offerings are short and immediately available. The senior common room has proved an ideal setting for these more modest and charming events, starting typically at 7 in the evening, when house members and friends are inclined to drop by after supper. This seems to make a good foil for the larger events, which of course are held in the dining room. In establishing an arts fund, we hope to further these developments with less limitations. It seems to me that we have an ideal mix between student presentations and more ambitious productions by artists from outside. But our ability to program these latter have been restricted until now. Again, this is the need, if there is the need for more equipment as we reach out to develop house artistic expression in all its forms. So may I echo what David just said, may the arts continue to flourish in Quincy, but with more scope as we get on a sounder financial base. I had my head screwed on right when 26 years ago I accepted Mac Fundy's invitation. I heard a member of the common room put her finger on just what makes this house so special. And here I echo what Peter told you. It's the lack of any one predominant type. We don't gather here expecting to find a majority of intellectuals, scientists, humanists, jocks, effetes. Sure, there's room for all of them. But we have and always have had, both in the JCR and the SCR, a wonderful mix of people, completely free of any type of prejudice. And above all, we've gotten to know each other and become enriched by each other all along through taking each house member as she or he is and finding out how that particular person ticks. The interests, the cares, the joys, even the gripes. People at Quincy House, as they love to say nowadays, can let it all hang out. For my part, I found it a great adventure and an important part of my attempt to understand what we mean by Harvard people and the house experience. Now to end up, I've been asked, and I feel a bit humble about this after this wonderful artistic treat that we've had here, but I've been asked to supply a musical coda. And so I'm going to sing two songs, and I'd like to dedicate them to Mary Jo Barrett.
I told you I'd come from Princeton to hear. And I'm about to sing you now, as inappropriate for me to have sung Princeton as it is here. For the name of the song is, I'm Saving Myself for Yale. Now Mary Ward and Mabel were sitting at the table down at the top hotel, working on a plan to get themselves a man. In their 30 years of bronze, have never once had they had qualms that they would fail to satisfy their craving, and never seemed to doubt that it was reckless to hope.
as I tell you, the name of this song is Old Rocking Chair's Got Me. I don't want you to put too close a correlation to singing it. And furthermore, you have to have a stretch of imagination to imagine one of these, because Joe Jay chooses to sit in as a rock.